Hello, my name is Keshwani. That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I, Keshwani. Today, we'll talk about ratios and proportions. A lot of the times you'll hear people use the term ratio and proportion as if they were synonyms, as if they were the same concept. Ratios and proportions are not synonym. They are not to be used. They are not to be used. How would you finish the sentence? We need the adverb here, obviously. They are not to be used. Synonymous is the adjective, and the adverb would be synonymously. That's the adjective. Ratios and proportions are not, the terms ratios and proportions are not to be used synonymously. They're not synonyms. They're two separate concepts, two distinct concepts. And today, before we start doing the problems, we'll take first few minutes to understand the fundamental differences between ratios and proportions. There are two fundamental differences between the concept of ratio and the proportions. So let's begin, shall we? Let's begin. So again, one more time, they are not synonyms, therefore they are not to be used synonymously. Synonyms are the nouns. Synonym is a noun. The adjective of synonym is synonymous. The pronunciation changes. Synonym, synonymous. They are not to be used synonymously. They are not to be used synonymously because they are not synonyms. They are different concepts. Let's find out what the differences are. There are, as I said, two fundamental differences between ratios and proportions. So let's begin. Here we have ratios and here we have proportions. Let's start with the first concept, for first difference, which is ratios. Ratios deal with like things. Ratios deal with like things. When we say like things, we do not mean like as in I like you. That's not what we're talking about. When we say they deal with like things, what we're talking about is that they deal with similar things. Similar things. Proportions, on the other hand, proportions deal with unlike things. Synonym of unlike would be dissimilar. They deal with dissimilar things. Similar, dissimilar. Like, unlike. They deal with dissimilar things. For example, in ratios, when we say they deal with like things, we're talking about things like boys and girls. That's a ratio. We might say that the ratio of boys to girls in the class is 3-4. If the ratio of boys to girls in the class is 3-4, and they tell you that if there are 9 boys in the class, how many girls would there be? Well, it would simply be 4 times 3. There would be 12 girls. But after having done that, it is quite natural to ask ourselves, so how many total kids are there in the class? How many boys and how many girls? What's the total? And we are able to add the two quantities, we are able to subtract the two quantities, and the reason we are able to add and subtract the two quantities is because they are like things, they are like concepts, they are like objects. We can add them, we can subtract them. For example, we may talk about the red cars in the parking lot and the blue cars in the parking lot. And if we are told that the ratios of blue cars to red cars to blue cars is 2-7, then then it's quite natural to ask ourselves that if there happens to be 10 red cars, how many blue cars will be in the parking lot? Well, there are 35 blue cars. Again, at the end, we might ask ourselves, so how many total cars are there? How many total blue and red cars are there in the parking lot? And we can add the two quantities. And the reason we are able to add them is because they are like things. We might talk about the ratios of, in the garden, we might talk about the ratios of daffodils and roses. And if we are told the ratios of daffodils and roses in the garden is 5-2, and if we are told that there are 14 roses, how many daffodils will there be? Well, if there are 14 roses, there will be 35 daffodils. So again, how many total daffodils and roses do we have? We can add them very easily because they are like things. They are similar things. They are similar objects. As opposed to proportions, where we deal with dissimilar things, unlike things, things that cannot be added or subtracted. For example, in proportions, we might say that one book costs $3. See, it's a proportion of book to dollars. One book costs $3. So then how many will 3 books cost? Well, if one book costs $3, Three books will cost $9, of course.
But are we able to are we able to ask ourselves at the end, so how much is $3 plus 37 books? Well, it makes no sense to go around adding books and dollars. The reason we cannot add books and dollars is because they are dissimilar things. They are unlike things. They cannot be added or subtracted. For example, we might talk about miles and gallons. So if I told you that my car gives me 30 miles a gallon, I get 30 miles off each gallon. The question is, how far would I be able to go if I have 9 gallons in my tank? Well, with 9 gallons, I should be able to go 270 miles. Again, at the very end, it'll be damn silly thing to ask ourselves, so how much is 37 miles and 4.2 gallons? It makes no sense to go around saying that. They're unlike things. They're dissimilar things. They cannot be added or subtracted. That's your cue that we're dealing with proportions and not ratios. In ratios, we can add them. Or we might talk about words and minutes. Words and minutes. And if we are told, for example, that a person can type, if we are told that the person can type 40 words in a minute, if the person can type 40 words in a minute, it is quite natural to ask ourselves, so how long will the person take to type 800 words? 4 times 2 is 8, so how long will it take the person to type 800 words? Well, 800 words will take 20 minutes at that speed. Again, it'll be damn silly thing to say, so how much is 3 words plus 3 minutes? Makes no sense. Do you understand? We're talking about words and minutes. Do you understand? By the way, on the side note here, I happen to be a damn good typist. I can type almost 40 words a minute, give or take a minute. Do you understand? Let's keep on going. That is what I like to put in the resume, give or take a minute. Let's keep on going, shall we? So we understand the difference now. Like objects and unlike objects, ratios and proportions. We cannot add them, we cannot subtract them. Let's talk about second fundamental difference, which is just as important to understand as far as ratios and proportions are concerned. So let's talk about second difference. The second most fundamental difference between ratios and proportions is that ratios are unit free. Ratios are unit free. They have no units. Whereas proportions must have units. A proportion without units makes no sense. Ratios are unit free. For example, if we talk about ratios of boys to girls, well, ratio of boys to girls is 3 to 7, it's just 3 to 7, it has no units. If we talk about ratios of red cars to blue cars, if we talk about the ratios of red cars to blue cars, if it's 2 to 5, then it's just 2 to 5, it has no units. Whereas in proportions, we must have units. We must have units. Here we have books, and here we have dollars. So that's your unit. It's one book for $3. So it's units here would be books per dollar. Or in real life, we don't talk about how many books we can buy with a dollar. In real life, we'll talk about how many dollars we have to pay for one book. But it has units, dollars per book, or words per minutes. I can type 40 words in a minute. So here, words per minute, or sometimes it's written as word per minute, but see, that's your units. Words per minutes, or miles per gallon. These are all proportions, and therefore they must have unit. A proportion without units is a silly thing. It doesn't exist. Let's do some problems, shall we? Let's do some problems. I don't know how many we'll manage to do, but we'll see how far we can go. So here we are told, here's the first problem. We are told that Mike can assemble 7 parts in 8 minutes. And you have to decide whether it's a ratio problem or proportion problem. It just doesn't really matter. You still have to solve the damn thing. But they're not the same thing, you understand? So here the question is, if that's what you're told, he can assemble 7 parts in 8 minutes, question is, how many parts can he assemble in 2 hours? How many parts can he assemble in 2 hours? Well, there are several different ways you can go about it. You can do it in a very classical way, and if you want to do it in a very classical way, we'll set it up as parts per minutes. So here we have parts per minutes,
and we are told that he sells 7 parts in 8 minutes. Question is, how many parts, which is our unknown, in 2 hours? We have to pay attention. Here we have hours, the rest, the originally we were given minutes. So we have to convert these 2 hours into minutes, it would be 2 times 60. And we just, this is a very conventional setup, nothing to it. You just solve it out, solve for x, and that's your answer. So let's do that. The x will simply be 7 times 2 times 60 over 8. So x is going to be our unknown. X is going to be 7 times 2 times 60 over 8. And then you do what you have to do. So here 2 will cancel out with 8 4 times, and 16 has 15 has 15 times 4 is 60. So that's it. And the answer is x equals 7 times 15. 7 times 15, 7 times 10 is 70, and 7 times 5 is 35. So it turns out that the answer is 105 parts. Turns out that this machine will be able to assemble 105 parts given 2 hours. As I said, this is a very classical way. Another way we could have looked at this thing is that to realize that it's 2 hours, which is 120 minutes. Okay, and we can split it up because we know it's 8 minutes. So instead of 8 minutes, do 80 minutes and 40 minutes. Okay, watch what happens. In 8 minutes, we can do 7 parts. If we can do 8 minutes, we can do 7 parts. So in 80 minutes, we should be able to do 70 parts. 70 parts. And if we can do 70 parts in 80 minutes, then in 40 minutes, we should be able to do 35 parts, half as much. There is your answer. 70 plus 35 is 105. So you can do it this way, which is a sort of non-classical way, which is the way I would have done, but this is more of a traditional way, the orthodox way, the classical way, the geeky way, the nerdy way, the academic way. Do you understand? And I did it for your benefit here, but this is the more straightforward way. Let's do the second problem, shall we? Let's do the next problem. If you can find a quicker way, if you can find a shortcut, why not? Why waste time if you can do it in a straightforward manner? Here's the next question. It says on a map, one quarter of an inch represents 5 miles. 5 miles. And if you don't like the nonsense of inches and miles, you can think of this as 1/4 centimeter represents 5 kilometers. It really doesn't matter. Do you understand? Question is, a distance of 135 miles or kilometers, if you like, kilometers or miles, makes no difference. 135 kilometers will be how many centimeter on the map? On the map, if you want to represent a distance of 135 kilometers, how many centimeters would that be? Again, I'm not going to do it in a classical way. Let's do it in a straightforward manner. We know that 1/4 inch or centimeter, if you like, 1/4 centimeter represents 5 kilometers, we are told. 5 kilometers. If one quarter of a centimeter on the map represents 5 kilometers, that implies that 1 centimeter should represent 5 times 4 or 20 kilometers. Of course, because it's 1/4 times 4. So that's 20 kilometers, that's my 5. Once you have it in the form of 1, then if you want to continue, you can set it up in a traditional way, because it's 1 now, it's easier to deal with. So here is your centimeter, here is your kilometers, and we know one centimeter is 20 kilometers. The question is, how many centimeters would be 135 kilometers? Solve for it. As you can see, it's 135 divided by 20. X equals 135 over 20. 135 over 20, I left no room there to actually do the division. Let's do it here. 135 divided by 20, which I'm going to write as 2 times 10, divide top and bottom by 2. How many 2's does 1 have? 1 has no 2's. 1 goes and joins the 3, becomes 13, and 13 has 6 2's. 6 2's are 12. Once we take away 12 from the 13, we are left with a remainder of 1. That 1 goes and joins the 5 and becomes 15. And 15 has 7 2's. 7 2's are 14. And then, we have a remainder of 1. We have a remainder of 1. And since we're dividing it by 10, it's just going to be 67 and a half divided by 10 is going to be 135 divided by 20. I was trying to get a shortcut. Look, 135 divided by 2 is 67 and a half. 67 and a half, not fifth. 67 and a half. And now we have to divide it by 10. 67 and a half, which I can write that as 0.5 if you like. 67 and a half divided by 10 comes out to be 6 and a quarter. 6 and a quarter. Yeah, that's the answer. You understand? And of course, in the real exam, whether you're preparing for GRE or GMAT or HESES or TEES or SAT, ACT, the answer choices are going to be represented. Answer choices will be presented to you in the form of multiple choice answers, and you have to be careful. One of the answer choices is 6.75, the other one is 7 and a quarter, the other one is 7. You have to be careful as to what you're picking. It is 6.75, even though I drew a blank for a second, I blanked out for a second, but that's the answer. Let's do next one, number 3. Number 3. If you want to do these problems yourself, as soon as I set up the problem, pause the video, do them yourself. It says it takes 24 minutes to do 3/8 of a job, 24 minutes. How long will the whole job take? Again, you can set it up in a classical way if you like, with the job and time if you like, or you can do it a non-classical way like the way we are about to do. We know it's going to take 3/8 of a job. We know 3/8 of a job takes 24 minutes. That is given to us. But if 3/8 takes 24, and that is nothing more than 24, that is nothing more than 3 times 8, that's your 24 minutes. If 3/8 takes 24 minutes, then that implies that 1/8 of the job, 1/8 of a job should take 8 minutes. We are done. We don't want 1/8, we want a whole job. Since we want a whole job, multiply both sides by 8. Voila. And 8 times 1/8 is your whole job, which will take 64 minutes. The answer is, it will take 64 minutes. Let's do next one, shall we? Number 4. Number 4. As I said, if you want to set it up in a classical way, that's up to you. We are told, number 4, we are told, Michael takes 3 hours to read 200 pages. Bob reads twice as fast. How long will Bob take to read 100 pages? Here are the answer choices, A, B, C, D, and E. It says how long it is in terms of minutes, how many minutes. And the problem is, it says how many minutes, not how long. And the answer choices are 45, 75, 90, 120, and 150. Do it out yourself if you like. Pause the video and do it yourself. So, let's begin then. We know Mike reads 200 pages in 3 hours. That is given to us. He takes 3 hours for 200 pages. But we don't have 200 pages, we have only 100 pages. So that implies that Mike can read 100 pages in hour and a half. In hour and a half, which is 90 minutes. If Mike can read 100 pages in 90 minutes, that would imply that Bob should take you take only 45 minutes.
Why 45 minutes? Bob should take only 45 minutes because we are told that Bob reads twice as fast. Well, if he reads twice as fast, then it stands to reason that he should take half as long. And since the first fellow is taking 90 minutes, second fellow should take 45 minutes. And the answer is 45, of course. Number five.
We are told that on a blueprint,
altogether we're going to do 6 of these videos.
This is ratios and proportions, 1 of 6.
And as you will see, higher and higher we go in the numbers, the problem will become more and more difficult, more tricky. So if you want to watch the later ones, because these are too simple for you, you can just switch to 5 and 6 and see if you can handle those problems. And if you cannot handle the problems in the 5 and 6, then of course you have to come back and do the earlier ones first. But as I speak, of course, we're just doing the first one. I have long ways to go before I have uploaded all 6 of them. Do you understand? Because I'm going to do 2 at a time. We'll do 1 and 2, and then we're going to do something else, and then 3 and 4, and then we'll do some other subject, some other topic, and then 5 and 6. Okay, here we go. On a blueprint, the handwriting is atrocious. And I think blueprint should be one word. On a blueprint, one quarter centimeter represents 12 meters. My driveway is 60 meter long. My driveway is 60 meters long. Question is, what is going to be the length? What is going to be the length of my driveway in terms of centimeters that is going to be represented on this blueprint? If the scale that is being used is 1/4 of a centimeter for 60 meters.
My driveway is 60 meters. How many centimeters? How many centimeters on the map?
But of course in the real exam they're going to be a little bit more refined, of course. This is just to save time. How many centimeters on the map is very simple. You can set it up in a very classical way, very nerdy, very geeky, very academic way, or you can just keep it simple.
Which is, you know, 1/4 centimeter. 1/4 centimeter represents 12 meters. But we don't have 12 meters, we have 60 meters, which is 5 times as much. So multiply this side by 5 and multiply this side by 5 and you're done. The answer is 60 meters will be represented by 5/4 of a centimeter, and therefore it is 1 1/4 centimeter. The answer is 1 1/4 centimeter.
That's it. 1 1/4 centimeter. Number six.
We are told that the ratio of P to Q is 2 to 5. We are further told the ratio of R to Q is 3 to 10. The question is, what's the ratio of P to R? What's the ratio of P to R?
Let's find out, shall we? Let's find out. Watch what happens.
We know that P to Q is 2 to 5. So let's make a note of it. P to Q is 2 to 5. 2 to 5.
We are also told that R to Q is
3 to 10. Okay, watch what happens. 3 to 10.
Okay, watch what happens. If we were to multiply these two quantities, we'll end up with a mess. We'll end up with P times R over Q squared. That's not going to get us anywhere.
What we want is P to R. Somehow we have to get rid of this Q. If you want to get rid of this Q and just have P and R, then of course what we need to do here is not to multiply the two quantities, but to divide the two quantities. If you divide this one, P to R, R to Q, then what will end up here? What will end up here is P to Q times, and we take a reciprocal of it, which is Q. We take a reciprocal of it, which is going to be Q over R. Q over R. And now we can cross out the Q's, and what will end up is P over R. And that's what we want. So we'll take the first ratio, which is 2 to 5, and multiply it by the reciprocal of the other one, which is 3 to 10. 3 to 10 will become 10 to 3. And that's your answer. That's going to be the ratio of P to R. We see a 5 at the bottom, we see 10 at the top. Let's divide top and bottom by 5. If we divide top and bottom by 5, 10 will become 2, and 5 will disappear from the bottom. And that's it, we're done. There's nothing we can do with 2 and 3. So it's 2, the answer is 4 to 3. The answer is 4 to 3. Answer is 4 to 3. This was one way of doing it. One more time, as I always remind you, this is a classical way, academic way, the nerdy way, the geeky way, the orthodox way, the mathematical way, the arithmetic way, the way your math teacher will expect you to solve it. Here's another way, okay? I'm going to do it. Where can we do it? Let's squeeze it here. I'm going to squeeze it right here, because the second way actually doesn't take too much time. So we have P to Q to R. Okay, watch what happens. Okay? Let's put demarcation here so we keep it separate. This is P to R. We already know it. This is P to R. We know that. That's our answer. P to R. Right here. P over R. Okay, watch what happens. P to Q to R. P to Q to R. This is a different method. Second method. We know P to Q is 2 to 5. 2 to 5. We also know that R to Q is 3 to 10. 3 to 10. But pay attention here. It is R to Q. Here we have Q to R. R to Q. R to Q would be 10 to 3. 10 to 3. R to Q would be 10 to 3. I said 10 to 3 and I wrote down 3 to 10. What the hell is the matter with me? 10 to 3. This is where I told you pay attention, and I myself made a mistake. Okay, watch what happens now. Listen very carefully. We realize, think of these as three different objects, three different kind of balls, three different kind of people, whatever you want to think of. If we have a 10 of them here and 5 of them there, it doesn't work. It doesn't work out. They have to be the same numbers. They have to be the same quantities. So here we have 10 and here we only have 5. And in the first part of the story, there are only 5 Q's, and here we have 10 Q's. We have to have the same number of Q's. So we make this into a 10. So we have a 10 here and a 10 here. As soon as you multiply that by 5, as soon as you multiply that quantity by 2, we must do the same thing here. Otherwise, the ratio of P to Q will not be the same. Before it was 2 to 5 and now it is 4 to 10. Well, 4 to 10 is same as 2 to 5. That's it, we're done. So how many P's we have? We have 4 P's. We have 4 P's. How many Q's we have? We have 10 Q's. And how many R we have? We have 3 R's. They did not change. And the question was, what's the ratio of P to R's? P to R is 4 to 3. Voila, 4 to 3. Same as before. So that's just another way of looking at it. You understand? And that comes in quite handy when you're dealing with complicated problems with a lot of work, a lot of calculations. Let's do number 7. In number 7, we have 3 business partners. We have 3 business partners, we are told. Partners. I believe that's how you spell partners, I'm not sure. 3 business partners A, B, and C agree, we are told, to share profits of $1,137,500 in the ratio of 1 to 3 to 7. Question is,
How much does each person get?
How much does each get?
If they agree to share their business profit in the ratio of 1 to 3 to 7, and if it turns out that at the end of the year we found out that the business made a profit of 137,500 at the end of the year, at the end of the month, whatever the time period happens to be, the question is, how will this money be split? Let's find out, shall we?
Well, we have A to B to C. A to B to C, and we are told that they have 1 to 3 to 7 ratio, which means we have total of 1 plus 3 is 3 plus 7 is 10. We have 11 parts.
The total is made up of 11 parts. What we have to figure out now is how much is each part worth? How much is one part worth? And that's very straightforward. Since there are 11 parts, that's the total amount of money. Divide this quantity by 11. That's what we're going to have to do. And that's exactly what we'll do. So let's do it, shall we?
So we have 1,137,500 over 11 is what we need to do.
But we're not going to leave it like this, because if we leave it like this, as you can see, it's a huge number. It's going to be too much work. So let's write this down as 1,375 times 100 over 11. That's the trick. Just split it up into a multiple of 100. And let's divide this number by 11, shall we? So let's begin. How many 11s does one have? One has no 11s. One has no 11s. Okay, pay attention. Pay attention. Stay with me in this story. It's very important. That one goes and joins the 3 and becomes 13. That one goes and joins the 3 and becomes 13. How many 11 does 13 have? 13 has 1 11s. 13 has 1 11s. After we take away 11 from the 13, we have a remainder of 2. That 2 goes and joins the 7 and becomes 27. How many 11 does 27 have? 27 has 2 11s. 2 11s are 22. After we take away 22 from the 27, we have a remainder of 5. That remainder of 5 goes and joins this 5 and becomes 55. And 55 would have exactly 5 11s. That's it, we are done. So the answer is, each part is worth 125 times 100, which is same as $12,500. Let's find out how much each one of them gets, shall we? Let's do it on the top. Good. A is very straightforward. A just gets one part. So A gets $12,500. B will get 3 times 12,500. 3 times 12,000, which is very straightforward. 3 times 12 is 36,000. And 3 times 500 is going to be 1,500. So he gets $37,500. That's what B gets. Let's find out what C gets. C gets 7 parts. So C is going to get 7 times 12,500. 7 times 12,500. Let's see what we can do.
7 times 10,000 is 70,000. 7 times 2,000 will be 14,000. And 7 times 500 is going to be 3,500. Let's say that's his share. So it's going to be 500. 7 looks like 87,500.
87,500. And if you want to verify your work, it's very easy. Just add up the three quantities. 12,500 plus 37,500 plus 87,500. And you should get what we started out with, which was 137,500. Well, we are getting 500 here. Let's see if we can get 137,000 here. So carry one. We have 7 plus 7 is 14, 14 plus 2 is 16, 16 plus 1 is 15, 5, carry 1, that's a good sign. We need 100 and, is that a good sign or a bad sign? That is actually a horrible sign. We need a 7 here. 7 plus 7 is 14, 14 plus 2 is 16, 16 plus 1 is 17. That is not good. I was too busy babbling.
And then 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 plus 8 is 10, 10 plus 3 is 13, you see.
So we get back what we started out with, which was 100 and 37,500.
Let's do the next one, shall we?
Problem number 8. Problem number 8. I think I'm going to stop at number 10.
I think I'm going to stop at number 10. Otherwise, the video will be too long. As I said, there'll be a series of 6 of them.
Until we are finished with all the ratio and pressure, ratio and proportion problems. And if you do all of these ratios and proportions problem, all of them, then you'll be ready for any ratio or proportion problem that you might encounter on GRE or GMAT or SAT or SATs or HESIs or TEs, it doesn't matter. You will be ready, you'll be prepared for this concept thoroughly. And that's the idea, do you understand?
Here's what we're given, number 8. We are told that if the ratio of x to y is 3 to 4, which of the following could be true?
Which of the following could be
true?
Doesn't have to be, could be true.
Here are the answer choices. A. So
here are the answer choices.
And I'm going to, in A, x is equal to 0, y is equal to 3/4. In B, x is equal to 3/3, y is equal to 2. In C, x is equal to 4, and y is equal to 5. In D, x is equal to 12, and y is equal to 9. This is a 12.
12 and 9.
And in E, x is equal to 9, and y is equal to 16.
Do what you have to do. Do what you have to do and find out which of them could be true.
Well, we know that we are told the ratio of x to y is 3 to 4. That has to be true. In answer choice A, x is 0. 0 divided by any number, doesn't matter what you put there, 0 divided by any number is just 0. So that, of course, does not equal the ratio of 3 to 4. That's x is 0, that's not the same. Just because you put a 3/4 here doesn't mean the x is 0. That's not it. What's going on in C? What is going on in C is that some people might think that if the ratio is 3 to 4, the people who are attracted to C, what they're thinking is that if you add the same quantity to top and bottom, the ratio does not change. Of course, the ratio changes. Just because we're adding 1 to both top and bottom does not mean it's the same ratio, obviously. And it's very straightforward. If the ratios of boys to girls is 1 to 2, and if you add 1 to both top and bottom, that's no longer the same ratio. Before it was 1 to 2, now it's 2 to 3. That's not the same ratio. So that's not the answer. I wonder what the answer is, huh?
Suspenseful. What's going on in here? What's going through the people's thinking who are attracted to 12 over 9?
But these people are not, it's not that they do not know their math.
Here, if you end up picking this answer choices, most people will end up picking these answer choices out of sheer carelessness, because
we need 3 to 4, what we have here is 4 to 3. 12 over 9 is 4 to 3, which is a reciprocal. We need 3/4, not 4/3. That's why it's wrong.
Who are the people who are going to be attracted to 9 to 16?
These people are thinking that if the ratio is 3 to 4, what they're thinking is that if you square the top and the bottom, nothing changes. Of course, everything changes. If the original ratio is 1 to 2, and if you square the top and the bottom, now the new ratio is 1 to 4. It's no longer the same ratio. This is not true. Let's look at answer choice B, shall we? Let's look at answer choice B. What's going on in answer choice B? In answer choice B, what is going on is that the ratio is 3 to 4. 3 to 4.
And what are we doing there? 3 to 4. Well, what we are doing there is that instead of 3 to 4, instead of 3 to 4, instead of x being 3, instead of x being 3, x is 3 halves.
So we're taking the top quantity and dividing it by 2.
If you divide the top quantity by 2, you must divide the bottom quantity by 2.
And now this is the same as 3 halves to 2. Which is exactly 3 halves to 2.
It's the same ratio. It's just that the original ratio is taken and it's halved. The original ratio is halved. The quantities, do you understand? Each of the quantities. Instead of 3 to 4, we have 3 halves to 2, which is the same ratio. Let's do number 9, the penultimate question.
Number 9.
This is going to be a very long video, but we'll see. Again, I would like you to do number 9 yourself first. Pause the video and do it yourself.
We are told that the ratio of boys to girls.
So as you can see, all these problems are all mixed up. Some of them are ratios, some of them are proportions.
Ratio of boys to girls in a class is 3 to 5. The question is, which of the following would be the number of students in the class, and we are told select one or more.
Select one or more answer choices.
Here are the answer choices: A, B, C, D, 16, 20, 72, 88, E, F, G, H, 96, 112, 210, and 396.
Now you might wonder, for those of you who are preparing for something other than GRE, you might wonder where you would see something silly like this. Well, you will see something silly like this on GRE exam. On the GRE exam, on the revised GRE, there is a type of questions where they give you answer choices, many answer choices, not 4 or 5 answer choices, but sometimes as many as 10 answer choices, and your job is to select all the answer choices that apply, that are true. And if three of these answer choices happen to be right, and if you only pick 2, you will not get any credit. And if you ended up marking 4 by mistake, then of course you will not get any credit. You have to find out which of these quantities could be the number of students in the class where the ratio happens to be 3 to 5. Well, if the ratio is 3 to 5, then the total part has to be 8. If the ratio is 3 to 5, the total part has to be 8, which means the total number of students in the class, whatever it is, must be some multiple of 8. And if it's not a multiple of 8, it cannot be the total number of students in the class, given the fact that the ratio is 3 to 5. That's the idea.
We can kill it. See, 16 is a ratio. 16 is a multiple of 8. It's just times 2.
20 will not work.
20 is not.
20 is not.
20 cannot be the ratio of boys to girls, because we can't have half a child. Do you understand?
We can't have half a girl or half a boy. What about 72? Is 72 a multiple of 8?
The answer is yes. 72 is simply 9 times 8. 9 8s are 72. And how do we know that? Because 10 8s are 80. If you have 10 of them, 10 8s are 80. 9 would be 8 less than 80, which is 72. What about 88? Of course, clearly, 88, of course, is a multiple of 8. So that is possible. This is possible.
What about 96? Is 96 possible? Let's find out, shall we?
We're going to do the work for 96 over here. We're going to erase all of these things. So far,
the answer choices that qualify are A, C, and D. And we'll pick up more here. A, C, and D so far.
What about 96? Is it divisible by 8? Let's find out, shall we? 96 divided by 8.
How many 8 does 9 have?
9 has 1 8.
9 has 1 8. After we take away that 8 from the 9, we have a remainder of 1. That 1 is going to go and join the 6 and become 6 and become 16.
And 16 has 2 8s. Turns out that it is in fact 12 times 8. This quantity is 12 times 8. And therefore, that one also qualifies.
It is possible to have 96 people in the class, 96 students in the class, if the ratio of boys to girls happens to be 3 to 5, or 5 to 3 for that matter. What about 112?
Let's find out, shall we? 112. 1, 1, 2. Let's see if it's divisible by 8.
How many 8 does 1 have?
1 has no 8s. 1 has no 8s. 1 is too puny to have any 8. That one goes and joins the 1, becomes
11. How many 8 does 11 have?
11 has 1 8. 11 has 1 8.
After we take away 8 from the 11, we have a remainder of 3.
That remainder of 3 goes and joins the 2 and becomes 32.
And what do you know? 32 does in fact turn out to be a multiple of 8. 8 4s are 32, or 4 8s are 32.
So that is also a multiple. That is 14 times 8. 14 times 8. That also qualifies.
Of course, it would have to be 14 times 8 because 112 is exactly, see this 4 more here, 96 plus 4 would be 100, and this is a 12. So this is from here to here, we go 16 more. And 16, of course, therefore, if this is 12 8s, it should be 14 8s. What about 210? I wonder 210 is a multiple of 8 or not.
210. How many 8 does 2 have? 2 has no 8. 2 goes and joins the 1, becomes 21. And 21 has 2 8s. 2 8s are 16.
After we take away 16 from the 21, we have a remainder of 5. And that goes and joins the 0 and becomes 50.
And 50 is not a multiple of 8.
50 is not a multiple of 8. We'll have 48. 48 has 6 8s.
48 has 6 8s. And we'll have a remainder of 2, which is need to be divided by 8, which means it is 26 and a quarter.
26 and a quarter. And we cannot have a quarter of a child. Do you understand? That'll be silly. That'll be silly. G does not qualify. And finally, 396. I wonder if 396 is going to qualify.
396 divided by 8. How many 8 does 3 have? 3 has no 8s. That 3 goes and joins the 9, becomes 39. How many 8s does 39 have? 39 has
4 8s. 4 8s are 32.
4 8s are 32.
After we take away 32 from 39, we have a remainder of 7. That 7 goes and joins 76. And 76 has how many 8s? 76 has 9 8s. 9 8s are 72.
9 8s are 72.
After we take away 72 from the 76, we have a remainder of 4.
We have a remainder of 4, and that 4 has to be divided by 8. So it turns out it is 49 and a half.
Again, we cannot have half a child.
It does not qualify.
The answer is, or rather, the answers are
A, C, B, E, F, and that's it. 5 answer choices.
Turns out that 5 of these 8 answer choices worked out. The very last one we're going to do, and we'll call it a day.
Do it yourself, okay? As soon as I set it up,
pause the video and do it yourself.
Number 10. We are told if P plus Q is 75% of 3P, if P plus Q is 75% of 3P, question is, what is the ratio of P to Q?
What would the ratio have to be of P to Q if we were told that their sum happens to be exactly 75% of 3P? How do we go about it? That's very simple. You just translate this into an equation.
P plus Q is means equal 75%. 75% is 3 quarters. 75% is 3 quarters right here. Of means times. And then 3P.
Let me just solve for it. That's all. Bring all the P's and all the Q's on one side. So we have a 4 here. Let's multiply both sides by 4. So if we multiply this side by 4 and that side by 4, we can get rid of this 4.
Now open the parentheses. We get 4p plus 4q would have to equal 3 times 3, which is 9p. Bring 4p to the other side, subtract 4p from both sides. P's are going to cancel out, and we end up with 4q equals 5p. 4q equals 5p, we want a ratio of p to q, not q to p, we want a ratio of p to q. So p to q, we bring the q over here, would be 4 over 5. Or if this is confusing you, if you don't like it, then rewrite it. There is no shame in it. There is rewrite this equation here, 5p equals 4q. Bring the p to this side if it makes it easier. So p to q, q's are going to cancel out, and now divide both sides by 5. If you divide this side by 5, 5 are going to cancel out, and divide that side by 5, and there you go. P to Q is 4 over 5. I don't know why I made it so damn silly. You should be able to see that P to Q will be 4 divided by 5. Oh, I did not give you the answer choices, did I? It's a bit too late in the game. But I'm going to give you the answer choices now, just in case you're curious as to what they look like in the real exam. The answer choices were A was 2 to 3, B was 3 to 2, C was 3 to 4, D was 4 to 5, and E was 5 to 4. And we just found out that the correct answer is 4 to 5. Answer is D. We're going to stop right here at question number 10, because it's, as I said, it's already been a very long video. We're going to do a total of 6 videos, and as I told you before, towards the very end, when he says 6 of 6 or 5 of 6, when he says 5 of 6 or 6 of 6, there you're going to find the difficult questions that appear towards the very end of the section in any of the exams, because these are all standardized exams. Since all of these are standardized exams, the GRE, the GMAT, the TEs, the SCs, the SAT, the SAT, these are all standardized exams, and therefore the questions are always laid out in terms of difficulty levels. The higher the number, the more difficult they get. So towards the end of each section, the questions tend to be more difficult, obviously, and those are the questions you're going to find when the video says 5 of 6 or 6 of 6. These were easy questions. The next video we're going to do will also contain easy ratio and proportion problems. The next 2, 3, and 4 will contain the medium ones, and the last 2 in the series will be the hard ones. Bye now.